guys, the wonderful Melinda Schneider joins me right now. How you going, Melinda?
Oh, great, Jason. So lovely to finally meet you and have a conversation with you.
Yes, I know. We've been talking over email and over the phone, you know, lining up this chat. And I was actually just thinking last night, I don't think we've actually ever met. So it's lovely to meet you too.
In this strange time, hey?
Oh, isn't it crazy? Isn't it absolutely crazy? How are you guys going?
Look, we're okay. We're okay. We're getting used to the idea of all of this now. It was a bit of a shock back in March because I was halfway, well, a month into my second leg of my regional national tour of A Farewell to Doris. And, you know, it was going so well that I had sold out shows happening. I was traveling all around Australia and really looking forward to getting to a lot of these places that I don't often get to go to. So it was a real disappointment to have to postpone my tour and a shock to really lose all of our income, not just me but my partner Mark, who's a singer from Choir Boys. All of their gigs were cancelled within a couple of days. So once we kind of picked ourselves up off the floor and realised, well, hey, this is not just happening to us, it's happening to everyone. You don't feel so alone and like you're so hard done by when it's happening to everyone else as well, I think.
No, that's exactly right. I mean, a lot of businesses probably won't reopen from all this, and like small businesses and a lot of families have been affected by this because, you know, no income and just things like that. It's heartbreaking, really, and it's the same in our industry.
Yeah.
I think the only thing in our industry is that I think we're going to be the last back on its feet because the last thing people are going to want to do after all this is go into a, you know, a show with 300, 400, 500 people, plus money's a bit thinner too, you know, so buying a ticket's going to be harder. So
yeah, I agree. I mean, I think people will be just, you know, chomping at the bit to go and see a live show, but there will be that fear. I mean, I still get anxious going into supermarkets, really.
Oh, so do I.
So it's weird, isn't it? It's just such a weird time. But I think it's been, you know, I think it is happening. I think not necessarily happening for a reason, but I think we can learn a lot out of this experience. I've learned a lot. I've kind of reevaluated the way I want to live my life. I'm definitely not going to be so work focused as I have been, which is, it's hard when you're, you know, self-employed and you're an artist and you're, you know, it takes a lot of self-focus to be a success. But yeah, I've kind of reevaluated what my idea of success is, which I have been doing for the last couple of years anyway. But
great. Yeah, that's awesome. I've learned a lot. I've learned how to Skype.
that's a very useful tool.
Oh, look, I'm absolutely hopeless when it comes to technology. And, you know, to be able to get on, though, and speak to people like yourself has just been great, Melinda. So, no, it's great to have you on. And what are you missing the most? I guess touring, you know, music and things like that, writing.
Look, even more than that, probably just going out for dinner or going down to a restaurant. Yeah. I'm missing that. You know, that's and the social aspect of life. But, yeah, for sure. Look, I really want to get to these 30 tour dates that I've had to postpone and get to all of these places. I've put them off until October, so I'm starting again in October, November, December and into next year now.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's given me some time to now record some new songs to finish my new original album, which I've been working on really for the last couple of years.
Oh, great.
And I haven't had an original album out there for quite a while, so I'm really looking forward to that. I've started my new record label in the last few weeks called Empower Records. So I'm empowering myself in lots of different ways.
Good on you. That's great. Awesome. Well, everyone will be looking forward to that originals album.
That's
great. Absolutely. Yeah. So your career, Melinda, you started like studied dance as a child. And then yep. You made your debut on A Country Practice. Is that right?
That was my acting debut. Yeah.
So musically you started singing at the age of 3?
I was on stage from 3 in my mum's shows and recorded with her first when I was 8 years old, which, you know, I'm not repeating that cycle for my son. I don't believe that that's really the right thing to do to kids. I think you should let them find their own path. But the good side of, you know, what came out of that is all of the experience that I gained, you know, before I was even 15. You know, I had a hell of a lot of experience under my belt as far as live performance and things like that. So, you know, there's positive and negatives that come from everything, Jason, I reckon.
Yeah, oh, there absolutely, absolutely there is. There's a positive and negative in everything, 100%. So you were introduced through through Doris Day's music. Who introduced you to Doris Day's music? Did you listen to that yourself or was your mum?
It was probably Calamity Jane watching that film on the Saturday afternoon movie on Channel 9, you know, and I loved Doris as the rootin' tootin' whip crackin' sharp shootin' tomboy that she played. And I fell in love with her then, and so I that love of her and her music and her films really followed me throughout my life. And it was in 2010 that I recorded my first Doris tribute album, Melinda Does Doris. And wrote the stage show all about her life. So I've been doing that project on and off for the last 10 years.
Yeah, and very, very successful too, because I'm in isolation in Dubbo at the moment. And I know a lot of people that went to you know, the Melinda Does Doris show here at the theatre, the entertainment centre.
Yeah.
And a guy just over the road, his dog was a part of the show.
Yeah,
no, don't ask me the name of the bloody dog.
Is he an English guy?
Yes.
Yeah, I think I know who that was. Yeah, that was a great dog.
Oh, beautiful, beautiful. And he was chuffed. He was chuffed that the dog got on stage with you here in Dubbo and that. So, and I mean, that's great. And to be inspired by someone like Doris Day and to be able to go out and sell out shows, as you just said, you had 30 dates that you've had to postpone, you know, or whatever, due to COVID. Like to be selling out gigs, Melinda, and stuff, singing something from somebody that you've admired, it's special, isn't it? Because I do the same thing with the John Denver stuff.
Oh, great. Yeah. You know? It's beautiful. I mean, I guess you've got to really choose an artist who you never get tired of singing. You never tire of their songs. And I feel that way about Doris. The songs are so timeless and they're so well written that you never get tired of singing them.
No, that's exactly right, 100%. People say that to me all the time with John's music as well. You know, it's just something that's just timeless music. You know, it's lovely music. And you're at home, so Mark, you're married to Mark Gable, lead singer of the Choir Boys.
Well, we're not married. We're living in unwedded bliss.
Oh, unwedded. You're not married. Okay.
No. We've been together for 12 years. And he's just my soulmate. He's my best friend in the whole world. And last week we did something very unusual. I rewrote the lyrics to his big hit Run to Paradise.
I've seen that.
And we've had over a million views on Facebook. It's amazing.
I've seen that. It's gone absolutely gangbusters. Gangbusters. It's great. I watched it because I follow both of you guys, and as well, I've seen it on one of the ABC pages on the Central Coast or something, put it up, and it's great. You've got to check it out, guys. It's absolutely fantastic. But that's good fun, isn't it?
Yeah, look, we have – life is never dull with Mark. He is completely nuts in the best possible way and keeps me laughing every day. And he's a great person to be in ISO with, I have to say.
Yeah, that's great. That's great, Melinda. You've won 6 Golden Guitars?
Yeah, that's right.
6 Golden Guitars. You've had numerous number one country music songs. You know, you go out, you've had a massive success with the Doris Day music, and you're amazing. You know, people love you, and I grew up listening to your music in the country music space. So I grew up 140 km west of Dubbo, so country music was everything to us, and yourself and Becky and Lee and Adam Harvey as well, and everyone. Yeah. It's it's amazing to have you here on the show, and for yourself now to be looking back at, you know, from where you started to now to still be in the industry that you love and enjoy, it must be great. You must feel so proud of yourself, you know, to be able to still do it.
Oh, thanks, Jason. Yeah, look, it is great. I'm very lucky to be able to do what I love. This year I'm actually celebrating 40 years in showbiz.
Wow.
So I started recording at 8. So, 40 years later I'm still doing it. And I am really lucky to be able to do this, and it's something that I love. I love people. I love touring. I love meeting different people in different towns. That's probably my favourite part of the show, is actually coming out afterwards and getting to have a chat with everyone, you know.
Yeah.
And, look, I say life is too short to really not do something that you love, but not everyone's able to do that. So I feel very blessed.
No, absolutely. And you should, because it's an amazing career, and it's not an easy game we're in, you know. You're there one minute and on the next, and you just, you know, it's up and down, and it's a roller coaster. So it's amazing. Absolutely. Who would be your biggest musical inspiration, Linda?
Oh man, there's so many. Well, my first one was definitely my mum, you know, being around her so much growing up, and, you know, she taught me how to harmonize and everything. And I think really out of everything she taught me, harmonies were the best gift that she could have given me. I just love singing harmonies, even probably more than singing the lead, you know. But look, I spent a lot of time in my bedroom listening to Stevie Wonder growing up. I love Stevie. Nancy Wilson was my favorite jazz singer. Ricky Skaggs. I was very much into bluegrass music as a teenager. So Ricky Skaggs is my biggest bluegrass idol. And I was so honored a few years ago to hear that he'd recorded a couple of my songs, which was just an amazing thing, because I just adore him. Who else? Look, I listened a lot to John Denver, Annie's Song. I used to sing that to my dog when I was, you know, my beautiful German Shepherd dog. And, you know, so many different musical influences. It's really hard, isn't it?
It is really hard, because when you're in the actual music space and you live and breathe music has a different effect on, I feel like it has different effect on musicians. It really, you just love music. You know, whether it's, you know, people can say, oh, my favourite artist is John Bon Jovi. Some people say, oh, mine's, you know, Stevie Wonder. And I think for us, it's, you know, it's a little bit of everything. We love what people do, but I think we admire their work more than anything as well, you know.
Yeah, and it just, I don't know, when you're musical, I guess you really understand what they're doing, and it hits you in a very profound, joyful way. I just got so much joy out of music as a kid growing up, you know, with the old Sony Walkman on and falling asleep in the back of the Ford Fairmont wagon that my dad had, going around to gigs with mum and dad on the weekends, and I'd fall asleep and have a blanket and a pillow in the back seat, and I'd fall asleep listening to Stevie Wonder, and I was just obsessed.
Yeah.
So a lot of really happy memories.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And a massive success for you in the past few years, it hasn't been all that long ago, was the Great Women of Country with Becky. Like that was huge, wasn't it? I love that record. That was so cool. That was a great album.
Thank you. Yeah, I loved making that. Becky and I always wanted to work together. We talked about it for many years before it happened. And I really admire what she does. She's very funny, very talented, you know, great entertainer.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, it was so much fun getting together and getting to sing all of those classic songs together. You know, we even did the Sydney Opera House with it. It was pretty incredible.
Oh, phenomenal. Absolutely. Yeah. So, like, you, not only in the actual music space that, you know, country music and music in general that you're in, you're also on Dancing with the Stars. You've done a lot of television work and that over the years.
Yeah.
You do a bit of everything. You're a jack of all trades. It's great, you know. And I remember someone actually said the other day that they love watching you on Dancing with the Stars. How long ago was that now?
That was in 2010. Yeah, that was just before I released that Doris album. 10 years ago. That was a great experience. I loved that so much. And, boy, did I get fit. Oh, my God. My body toned up. It was just hard as a rock, my body. It was just incredible.
Yeah, it's amazing, isn't it? When you've got to do something and you get motivated to do it, it's amazing what it just shows you what you're capable of doing, isn't it? Something like that.
Oh, 8 hours of ballroom dancing every day. That's what we had to do. That was how long we had to dance every day. And 6 weeks before the show even went to air, we were training 8 hours a day. So, man.
You're kidding. Far out.
Full on. It was like being an Olympic athlete.
Yeah. Who else was on that year, Melinda, with you?
I think Rob Palmer won it that year. Yep. The gardening show. Who else was on? Kyle Sanderland, ex-wife.
Kyle was on there, wasn't he?
his ex-wife, Tamara, she was on there. Alex Favola was on. Yeah, it was a really nice group of people. I loved it.
Would have been great. You make such great connections on those TV shows, don't you? Like I come off one and you just make such, you know, great friends with everyone on them. Because you're pretty much just living in each other's pocket for so long, aren't you?
Oh, it's definitely an alternate universe, yes.
It is.
It's like a bubble. But it's really, and it's such a kind of a, you know, full on and can be traumatic experience too. So you bond very strongly with the people on the show because you're all in the same boat.
Exactly right, 100%. Melinda, at the end of every chat, I have a little thing called Curious Questions that I like to ask. And they're just a couple of questions for people at home. And the first one is, have you been able to maintain motivation during isolation? And if so, how have you done it?
Look, I've got the opposite problem. I'm a bit too motivated. I need to stop. I need to learn to stop. So I'm trying to be conscious of not making every post a winner and not being the workaholic that I used to be. You know, even the last 24 hours, I said to Mark, my brain feels like it's throbbing. And he's like, Melinda, you've been on the laptop for the last 3 days nonstop. Just have a break, for God's sake. So, you know, it's more the opposite for me.
No, it gets like that, doesn't it? You know, it does get like that because you start thinking, what can I do? You feel hopeless. It's like you feel like you can't do anything. You feel just like a worthless feeling. I've noticed why I started this up, and I've learned so much from doing this, you know, and I'm the same. It's like a full-time job.
Well, it gives you a focus. It gives you something to focus on, doesn't it?
It does, absolutely.
At a time when we've got no control, really.
Exactly right, 100%. Melinda, what do you reckon off the top of your head would be one of your biggest highlights thus far in your career? You've had so many, but at the end of the day, is there one that sticks out?
I think performing at the Opera House, at the concert hall, 4 times in the last 8 years, that's been a real highlight for me because it's not something that a country artist would normally get to do.
No.
And I've taken my Doris show there 3 times in different incarnations, once with Tom Burlinson, and then I did another show called Hear Me Roar with a whole bunch of girls a couple of years ago. We sold out 2 shows at the concert hall.
Wow.
So those achievements have probably been the most exciting because it's such an iconic venue, and to have 2,000 people in the concert hall who've paid to come and see you, it's just that, if anything, I mean, I don't really get caught up on, you know, what, you know, my successes. I don't think about them that much. I kind of go, okay, well, done that. What's next? You know, I kind of focus on what's next.
In the past, you look forward. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't dwell on them, but when I thought about that, I'm like, well, I can actually be really proud of that. That's an achievement that, you know, that I'm proud of.
Amazing. Absolutely. Yeah, good on you. That's great. And one more for people at home, Melinda.
Yeah.
Who would be one of the most interesting celebrities you've ever met? And what do you think made them interesting?
Oh, boy. That's a tough one. Well, look, for a start, Mark Gable is definitely the most interesting celebrity I've ever met. When I met him first, when we first met 12 years ago, because I'd never met him before that, even though we've both been in the industry for many years, our paths never crossed until I met him at this charity event, and you know, he asked me out on a date, but he was pretty very interesting. Who else? Oh man. There's so many.
I know, and it sort of catches you out, that question. It's funny because you try and explain. You know, everyone's human, aren't they? At the end of the day, so it doesn't matter like who you've met. Everyone's human. But I think what inspires me the most about meeting some celebrities that I've met over the years is how they've created the art to get to where they are and who they are today. I think that's what amazes me a lot more about them.
Yeah. Look, and it takes a certain character to do that, you know. Some celebrities I've met haven't been positive experiences, and I don't want to share those because I don't want to ruin it for people.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's better when you don't meet your idols, you know, because you might not like what you see. As Mark says, we do what we do in this business because of our flaws, not because of how well balanced we are, you know.
Yeah.
Really. Who on God's earth would put themselves up on stage in front of a couple of thousand people and say, please like me, please applaud, please stand up and clap your hands? And it's pretty weird when you think about it.
It is. So
it takes an unusual kind of person to do what we do, I think.
Yeah. No. Melinda, thank you so much for coming on for a yarn. I really appreciate it. And it's actually lovely to finally actually meet you face to face. And everyone at home's, you know, we love you. You're amazing. And thank you so much for coming on for a chat. We really appreciate it.
Oh, thanks so much, Jason. Lots of love to you. And I hope ISO isn't too painful for you.
No, touch wood, touch wood. Everything's starting to lift slowly. So fingers crossed.
Okay.
See you soon.
Thank you. See ya. Bye.